Sunday school report, okay? We had 45 members, 16 contacts, and total presence was 45. Our Sunday school has not gotten back to pre-COVID numbers, but we hope that if you used to come to Sunday school and you have been laying out for whatsoever reason, let's get started back. Some of that's got to do with the summertime, I'm sure, but our numbers are kind of low in Sunday school. Now, today we have a very special guest. We have our children. This is the fifth Sunday, and so we're going to have our children to come up. They're sitting down here. Now, if you have your parents here or grandparents, we'd like you to sit with them. If not, then your Sunday school or not Sunday school, children's church parents, which is Judy's and Kayla, you can sit with them this morning, okay? But we're glad to have them. As I said, today is going to be geared toward our young people, and we will have communion at the end of the service. But we're glad that you're here. Now, if you are here and you have some family members, we're going to kind of make this the family day, okay? I want you to sit together. Usually we're all scattered out, and some of them in the choir will be coming out in just a minute. But if you're here with family members, you sit with your family, and that's going to be the case and accustomed to do on the fifth Sunday, okay? We welcome all those who are visiting with us by way of Facebook. If you missed out on the Wednesday night service, I have shared it on my Facebook page. It's also available on YouTube. I had a lot of interest on the Blood Moon message, and so if you can see that, it's available there if you'd like to see it, okay? Let me run over the announcements right quick. Yeah, y'all snuck in while I wanted to get started. It was running a little bit late. All right, we have some upcoming events. What's happening tonight at Bull Swamp Church at 6 p.m.? This Sunday singer, we have not had one in over a year, okay? March was the last one I think we had. We might even cancel that one. Tonight, 6 p.m., our three churches are going to come together at Bull Swamp. We're going to sing. The choir's going to sing. The Bowling Girls are going to sing. Linda and hopefully Mary's going to be singing a little bit with us too. And also bring finger foods, okay? If you want to stay for the fellowship, bring some finger foods and be a part of that tonight, okay? Nod your head like a billy goat. You're coming, right? Okay, thank you very, very much. Now, let me go down the list that is in the bulletin and add some things to it. June the 6th, I know we did not have any high school graduates, but I've asked Doc to compile a list of anybody who's graduated from any level, and we will be reading that next Sunday in honor of them. There's also going to be a drop-in baby shower for April 20 from 3 to 5 p.m., and that's next Sunday. Fun day, June the 12th. We're gearing up for a big time. If you volunteered last Sunday to bring candy, I need that by this Wednesday night. The youth are going to be making little bags with tracks and candy, and so if you get that to me this coming Wednesday night and put it in the usher's room, and they're going to be making those bags. Nod your head like a billy goat. You didn't go to sleep on that one. You understand that. Thank you. Bible school begins June 13th through the 17th. Theme is Rocky Railroad. If you're interested in helping, please do so. Miss Bonnie Bowler would like to see the social committee. Where you want me? Down front. The social committee right after church, right down here on my right. Okay? Okay. Y'all didn't sleep through that either, right? Father's Day, June the 20th. That's kind of, as you know, about every year, I take a Sunday off there for our anniversary, and this is our 48th year of being together, and so we're going to be gone most of that week, okay? And so Bob is going to be filling in for me on June the 20th. I do want a picture. If any of the ladies are here, I do want to get a picture of the fathers. We've got a recent picture of the ladies, and we'll get a recent picture of the fathers too, okay? All right, moving right along. July the 18th, the kids are going to be going to Camp Levita. We still have two children that are looking for sponsors. And how much is that, Judy? You remember?
$250.
Per child.
Mini camp is $130, and full
weekend $250. Okay, all right. If you're interested in giving a half scholarship or a full scholarship for the children, $235. So if you're interested in helping that, we have two children that has yet to be sponsored. We're glad that all of our children are going. I think it's going to be real good, okay? Then August 22nd, where is Maria? Maria, this is my communication with you. Please call and see if we can get a shelter for that on the 22nd.
That's
so we don't have to claim to obey, okay? Anything else need to mention? Y'all look good. How much they pay y'all feeling for me? I think Joe and Jan threatened y'all. That's good. I'm glad we got some in, sir. They're going to be singing just a minute. Now, we're going to start our service with a Memorial Day video, right? Oh, that's what we're doing, the special. So I just need to turn it over to you and let you do your thing, right? Okay. All right, we'll ask Laura to come up here and do our call of worship. Okay.
Good morning.
Good morning.
This is, I like this song. It's two songs in one song. So if y'all stand up and sing with us, you can clap your hands, do whatever you need to. This is a good song.
Just one moment.
Okay, hold on.
Grayson Dykes and his family, the Lord be with him. Please pray for Will Bramlett's mother, Mary Bramlett. She's hanging on. This morning she has not passed, so let's continue to pray for her and her family. Pray for Miss Dot Driggers as she undergoes cancer treatment. Pray for Georgia Ann. She will be going to the hospital at 9:30 Wednesday morning for her heart surgery. And I will update you when I know something on that, but just lift her up, especially on Wednesday morning. Would you remember, please, my daughter-in-law's mother, Judy Fleming? She has had to go back to the hospital. She has suffered tremendously from pneumonia. The doctors have told her that they thought that they could control the cancer and give her another 10 years of life, but they're having problems with the pneumonia issue. And so I ask you to pray especially for her this morning. Daniel McGrew, please pray for him. He's having issues from a bicycle wreck he had years ago. It's taking its toll on him, so let's lift up Daniel in prayer. We also have Wade Bowen and Michael Bennett. Let's pray for these this morning. May we bow our heads and our hearts together and we approach the throne of grace. Heavenly Father, you're our God and we're your people. We thank you, Lord, that you have always been there for us. We thank you, Lord, that you meet us, dear God, in the valleys as well as on the mountaintops. You minister to us with your spirit and with your word. And Lord, when we need Christian friends, Lord, you surround us with our brothers and our sisters to help lighten the load that we carry and share. I ask you this morning, Lord, to touch the names that are mentioned to you. I ask your hand of mercy to rest upon those, dear Lord, who are facing death. I pray, Lord, for those, dear God, who need a touch of healing. And I pray, Lord, for all those, dear God, who are on our list this morning and also Wednesday night. Just touch them with your loving hand. I thank you, Lord, for every heart in life that's in this place today. But I thank you, Lord, for this day and how special it is. Lord, Memorial Day is the day we remember those, dear God, who have given their life for our freedom. Dear Lord, they have paid a tremendous price. And we are so grateful, dear Lord. We are here today living in a free country that we can worship without hindrance because of the blood, Lord, that was shed on foreign soil to give us that freedom. May we never take it for granted. It's not just a day to barbecue. It's not just a day to boat ride. It's a day, Lord, that we honor and remember there, Lord, the fallen heroes of our land. May we never forget. May our nation never forget. Now bless us this morning, Lord, as we go forward in our service. Honor us with your presence, and we're going to give you the glory of everything it accomplished. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said,
Amen.
Congregation, be seated. service this morning, you're going to get a plastic soldier. You're to take that home and put it on your dashboard in your car, and it is to remind you to pray for our military. And Ms. Felicia will be giving those out at the end of the service in the back, okay? All right, let's get a hymn book. It's be on the screen, I think, and we're going to sing. Page. Since everything is geared around the children this morning, I've got a song that I knew they would be able to sing. Y'all know that song, don't you? I got peace like a river. So this is to remember. So I want everybody standing and singing. I got peace like a river.
I decided today, I kind of do this a lot, but I decided since it was to tomorrow is Memorial Day. I wanted to honor and recognize anybody who has served in the service, who has passed away. I know that that's why we have Memorial Day, for the men and women who fought and died for our country. And this is a tribute by Ronald Reagan for our soldiers, and I wanted to play this. And if I cry. And then afterwards, I had a song that I wanted to play, and I want anybody who wants to come up and sing with me to please sing, because someone's going to be singing with me on the thing. So don't be embarrassed. Just please come up and sing with me. I feel like it's a way we can honor our soldiers who fought and died, and the ones who are currently serving, and the ones who have passed away. When Daniel's died, Dad died in 2015. It was really hard to sit there and hear taps played, and then they handed him a flag, and it changed my life. So if you'll watch with me.
Sometime back, I received in the name of our country the bodies of four Marines who had died while on active duty. I said then that there is a special sadness that accompanies the death of servicemen, for we're never quite good enough to live. Not really. We can't be. Because what they gave us is beyond our powers to repay. So when a serviceman dies, it's a tear in the fabric, a break in the whole, and all we can do is remember. It is, in a way, an odd thing to honor those who died in defense of our country, in defense of us, in wars far away. Imagination plays a trick. We see these soldiers in our mind as old and wise. We see them as something like the founding fathers, grave and gray-haired. But most of them were boys when they died, and they gave up two lives, the one they were living and the one they would have lived. When they died, they gave up their chance to be husbands and fathers and grandfathers. They gave up their chance to be revered old men. They gave up everything for our country, for us. We owe them a debt we can never repay. All we can do is remember them, what they did, and why they had to be brave for us.
Can't take that away. And I'm proud.
who are presently serving, all those who have loved ones who have died serving our country. God bless you. God bless you. Moving service. Moving service. Now, as promised, everything this morning is going to be geared toward our young people. We have a scripture that we're going to put on the screen. I'm going to give you a break. I know you've been getting a little bit this long. I'll let you sit down as we read the scripture. It's found in Revelation chapter 22, verse 17. You can read it on the screen with me if you like. And the Spirit and the Bride says, come. Let him that hears says, come. Let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take of the water of life freely. The title of the message this morning is God's Last Invitation. Lord, I pray that you will bless the preaching and reading of your word. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said,
amen.
God's Last Invitation. Now I want you to pay attention. I'm going to talk long this morning, but I want you to listen, okay? Have you ever gone down the road and you looked over the pasture and you saw a big old sign that says, no trespassing, keep out? You saw a little pond, you say, well, that pond would be good to fish in, but there was a big old sign, trespassers will be prosecuted, keep out, just stay away, nobody want it. Well, that's the way the world is today. But friends, I want you to know that's not the way it is with God. God says, we're open. We're open. My altars are open. My churches are open. My invitation is open. My arms are open to whoever will, whoever, anybody that wants to come, you are welcome to come in. God starts this message in the Old Testament and he brings it right on through to the New Testament. He says these words in Isaiah 55:1. Everyone who is thirsty, come to me. Come to the drink the water of life. Come. Come eat. Come by. Isaiah 18:1. Come now, let us reason and rationalize together. Though your sins may be dark as sin or dark as scarlet, they can be white as snow if you will just come and let me into your life. Then in the New Testament, these are the words of Jesus. Matthew 11:28. Come all ye that are heavy burdened. Just come. John 6:37. He that comes unto me, I will in no wise cast out. So God's invitation is wide open. Then as we read this scripture before us, God had taken a man by the name of John. He was banished to the Isle of Patmos for preaching the gospel. And God gave him a revelation of what was going to be in the end time. This was going to become the last book of the Bible. And it seems that right before God closed the book, he looked down and said, John, now wait a minute. I want to give one last invitation to whoever will listen to come and partake of my salvation for all of eternity. Now let me ask you a question. A question that you don't have an answer for. Is this your last invitation today? Now I know what everybody says. Well, I'm young and full of life. You know, I'm not going to die tomorrow. I'll have many times to sit under the sound of the gospel. I'll listen to this preacher preach and I'll listen to the invitation saying. But I want to remind you that we do not know that. I remember a church that I pastored years ago, actually it was my first church, Langston Baptist Church. Before I went there was an RA leader. Now, you know, we used to have royal ambassadors, that was the RAs. And we had GAs, which was girls in action. Then we just kind of throw them all together, now we have children in action. But before then, he was the RA director of this church. And he took the RAs camping. They went camping, and after they got through eating, the boys wanted to go swimming. Well, they talked him into it. He really didn't want them to go into the pond, but they went anyway. And as they were swimming out of the pond, one of the little RA boys, 12 years old, got cramps in his leg. They tried to reach him, but he drowned that day. Out on an innocent RA trip. But there he had his last invitation to receive Christ. So we're not promised tomorrow. So today I want to tell you, if God is giving you an invitation, do not wait to respond. Many times we'll sing an invitational song and all of a sudden the Holy Spirit just prompts. Let's sing one more verse. Let's just sing one more verse. I know we've sang it through already, but let's go and sing that one more verse. Do you know why we're singing that verse? That's for you. That's absolutely for you, that you would come and respond to the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now I want you to notice this morning who it is that gives this invitation. First of all, we are told that the Holy Spirit gives it. The Spirit says, come. Now who is the Holy Spirit? That's the hammer that drives the nail of the gospel deep, deep into your heart and gives you that feeling of needing Jesus in your life. That's that lump in your throat that you feel this morning of knowing that you need something that the preacher is preaching about today. That's that funny feeling that you get. That's your conscience telling you that there's more to life than what you are living. There was a man by the name of Paul. He met God on the Damascus Road. And God spoke to him and said, Paul, it's hard to kick against the pricks. Now what he meant was this. It's hard to resist the impression of the Holy Spirit when he draws you to come and know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. But not only does the Holy Spirit call us, the Bible says the bride calls us. You see, you and I are the bride. We're the church. The reason we exist is to see people saved. Now, we have a lot of other things going on. I mean, we love to meet and eat. We love to meet and gather. We just love everybody's company. But the main reason, brothers and sisters, that we come together is to see unsaved people get right with the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, at the end of this service and every service that I will ever preach until I'm dead, I will stand down front and I will represent God. I will be his proxy. And I'm asking anybody out there who is an unbeliever to walk this aisle and publicly say, I want to know Jesus Christ as my personal Savior. And as you walk down that aisle and you say, I want Jesus in my life, you take my hand like taking the hand of God and I'll pray a prayer with you. And at that moment, friends, you will invite Jesus into your heart and you will be gloriously saved and you will be answering the invitation that God gives to his people. Not only does the Holy Spirit beckon us, not only does the bride, which is the church, beckon us, but the heavenly city of God beckons us. Come and be saved. O land of rest for thee I sigh. When will the moment come when I shall lay my armor down and dwell at peace in home? The war is over. We come to the cross and all of a sudden that battle in our soul is ended. We have peace with God. We have eternal rest with God. You don't have to wait to eternity. It starts right now. And all of a sudden you'll go home feeling so relieved and the burden is lifted off your soul and you lay down in bed tonight and you say, why didn't I do this 10 years ago? Might not have been about 10 years ago, but if you were, why did you do this last week? You knew the Holy Spirit was dealing with you. Why did you wait so long to enter into God's holy rest? Now think about the opposite for just a minute. There's eternal rest, but there's also eternal unrest. Where the Bible says there is weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. Now think about the opposite there. Here over here enjoying the peace and the heaven that blessed that God gives. And over here there's weeping, there's crying, tears of pain, tears of sorrow. Why didn't I accept God's invitation when he wrote it? Why didn't I accept his last invitation in his holy word? Then there's wailing. Your cries will become uncontrollable. Oh, God! Oh, God! But they're going to fall on deaf ears because it's too late. You've entered into eternity without God. And then the Bible says an interesting thing. It talks about those who are in the unrest gnashing their teeth. Who do you think the gnashing of teeth at? I think it's Christians. I think it's Christians because Christians live around unlost people all the time. We don't ever go knock on the door. We never share Jesus. We work with people all of our lives. And we never walk up to them and say, I'm a believer. Would you like to become one? Would you like to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Well, not only does the heavenly city bid us to come, every listener, every hearer, when the invitation is given, let me tell you, brothers and sisters, we're singing a song that's been picked out by the preacher, the song leader. And as we sing, you all know what's going on. Every believer is wanting every unbeliever to come get saved. I promise you, as we stay in this service and stand and sing, everybody that knows Jesus is hoping and praying that everybody in this building who's never received Jesus will step out of that aisle and walk down and publicly say, I do to Jesus.
Amen.
It's going to happen. You see, brothers and sisters, that's what the Bible tells us is so important. You see, here's what I think. When we get to heaven, you know, we got all of eternity. And I believe there'll be a sign put up on the billboard. I don't know if it'll be one of them electronic signs or one of them change the letter sign, but I think God's got these signs over heaven, you know, to tell us where we're going to want to do. And I believe there's going to be big old signs that this coming Sunday, all the Providence Baptist Church people are going to get together and worship. Think about that now. It ain't just going to be us. It's going to be all of them in the cemetery. It's going to be every preacher that we've ever had. We're all going to come together and say, hey, I remember you. Yeah, you taught me in Sunday school. We worshiped together. I read your name about all the things that you did and what, how God blessed you and gave you so many baptisms and helped build the buildings and all like that. But then, we're going to start looking around and say, I wonder where so-and-so is. Where's so-and-so? You know, they used to sit on the third pew back there from the back. Where are they? And then we realize they weren't saved and they're not part of God's eternal rest. What a sad day. What a sad day. Well, secondly, who are those who are invited? It says all that are thirsty. Salvation is simple. And God uses simple illustrations to tell us how easy it is to get saved. All you got to be is thirsty. And you go and you drink a big glass of water. And all of a sudden, God satisfies you just by drinking that water and receiving Jesus. That's how easy it is. There's many, many stories in the Bible of people who found satisfaction in Christ. They had thirsty souls like Zacchaeus. He wanted to see the Lord. And he climbed up that sycamore tree and all of a sudden, Jesus came by and said, Zacchaeus, come down. And that day, peace and love came to Zacchaeus' heart, and his thirst was quenched. You see, if we have a thirst that needs to be quenched, we'll be out playing and working, and it's so hot, we go and get a big old bottle of water, we drink it down. I said, that's so satisfying. Ain't nothing like a good big old bottle of cold water. But here's the thing. 2 hours later, you're still thirsty. You're thirsty again, right? But friends, when you drink of God's eternal water, you never, ever get thirsty again. There was a fellow that was having troubles in his life. He went to an army chaplain. Unfortunately, army chaplains ain't much on evangelism. He said, oh, you'll be all right. Just go to church when you have a chance. Read your Bible when you have a chance. It'll be okay. But it wasn't okay. And finally, he found a preacher that would tell him what was wrong. Listen, your soul is thirsty for Jesus, and you need to invite Jesus in your heart. If you'll do that, then that thirst will be quenched. And that's what he did. He listened to the preacher, but he disobeyed the chaplain. There was a maid one time that applied for a job at a large house. She came, she did her work tremendously. She was a great asset. But during a break, the owner of the house would notice the maid would open the Bible, lay it on her lap, and just look at it. But she noticed a perplexed look on her face. She said, are you having trouble? He said, I'm in such misery, ma'am. He said, I have a Bible. And I know there's wonderful stories in this Bible about Jesus. I've heard people talk about it. But she said, I cannot read. I can't read a word of it. Ma'am, will you help me and will you show me how to quench this thirst that I have in my soul for Jesus? And you know what? She led that maid to the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Well, it also says that whosoever will. Remember, think about John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes, and that's what the Bible says right here, there's the whosoever can come and know Jesus Christ. We sang a song right here. There's room at the cross for you. Now think about this. The cross stands upon the hill of Calvary. And hundreds of thousands of people have made their way to the cross. A lot of you, one day you heard an invitation. You heard a preacher ask you to come to Christ. And you went to the cross and there you knelt by faith and you said yes to Jesus. Listen to me. Listen good now. Of all the hundreds and thousands of people that have come to the cross, there's still room for you. Amen. God's held space out because he wants you to come and be gloriously saved. So he says to whosoever. Now, who are those who want to be saved? That's the second group. He said, all those who want to be saved, come and get saved. I've been visiting before, and I've heard this more times than I count on my hands and toes. Preach it, if I came to church, the roof would fall in. Anybody ever told you that? But you know what? The roof don't fall in. It don't fall in. I mean, you come, whether you sit on the back pew or the front pew, the roof is sturdy, it ain't gone nowhere, it ain't nothing. You see, friends, you're wanted here. You're wanted here. This whole service is about you. This whole audience is about you. All the playing and the preaching and the singing is about you. Getting rid of your old life and coming into new life with Jesus Christ. You see, brothers and sisters, here's the way things work. You might not have connected the dots, but this is how it is. Years ago, they met in this little white building over here. You know what happened? It got filled up. Well, we gotta have room. What are we gonna do? Well, we're gonna fight and fuss about money a little bit, and we'll get a better church. That's, it always goes on in the Baptist church. And so, guess what? They built this building. You know what happened? It starts filling up. It's full today. Three-fourths of the congregation is here. People are not going to have, you never have 100% occupation, okay? Never occupancy. Never happens. Now, what's going to have to happen next? Well, somebody's going to have to fight and fuss over money. Somebody out of the stewardship committee said, preacher, we'll be broke if we build another worship center. Well, brothers and sisters, I promise you this. Whether I'll be here, whether somebody else, when you build it, brothers and sisters, you'll fill it up, and years from now, somebody might be fighting about filling that one up too. That's the way it works, brothers and sisters. God fills up what we have with people who are earnestly coming to seek the gospel, and the roof stays where it is. Now, what is the invitation that's given? Come and receive the water of life. Again, it's different, friends, than the water we drink. You take a drink of water on this earth with your body, and all of a sudden you thirst again in 2 hours. But when you come and drink the water of eternal salvation, your soul will never thirst again. Now understand something. You cannot live without water. Your body is made up of water. You have to have water. Water quenches the soul. Water is God's trademark for every living thing. Everything has to have water. You and your soul cannot survive without the water of life, which happens to be Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
There was a 71-year-old man that came one time. He came forward and said, I want to be saved. I want to come to Jesus. And the preacher was talking to him. He said, well, you have to make an agreement with God. Okay? What's the agreement? He said, if you provide a sinner, he provides the Savior. Now, that's it. Do you know any sinners that you'd like to provide this morning? Would you like to come as a child or whatever? Say, I'm a sinner. Well, God's gave us a Savior in Jesus, and y'all can come together and meet and be gloriously saved. Amen? That's it. All you got to be is a sinner. I remember an old man. He was in 78 up in Woodruff, South Carolina. God gloriously saved him, and he'd get up in every service and testify. He said, you know, I've lived a long life. He said, but I'm the happiest I've ever been since I came to know Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Now, he was a character. He always had something to say and do. This ain't got nothing to do with the service or the message, but I'm going to share it with you anyway. He said, preacher, you know what? He said, then I can buy you for what you're worth and then sell you for what you think you're worth. That's what he tell me. Oh, man. Bless his heart. Bless his heart. Water's free. The water of life is free to anybody that wants it. Around this time every year, we have people that get diplomas. They walk across the stage and they get a diploma. Some people graduate, come along. Some Magna come along. Some come along. They're not getting that. They're not getting free. Those that diploma they get and the rewards they get and the awards they get shows that they put in a tremendous amount of work to get what they got. I think your brother Jay Hong back there and all the awards that he's gotten all over the United States for the papers that he's written and the accolades that's been given on him. But friends, he didn't get those awards free. He put in a lot of tremendous hard work to earn those accolades and praises. But friends, that's not the way it is with God. You come to God, you don't work for his salvation. You come and all of a sudden, brothers and sisters, he gives you freely his eternal life. You provide the sinner, he provides the Savior. You see, when God created you, he had a plan. You know what his plan was? To send his son to an old rugged cross because he loved you, Hollis. To send his son to an old rugged cross because he loved you, Will. He loved you beyond measure that he sent his son. That was God's plan. So what has to happen? You need to trust the plan. Okay, Lord, you did this for me and I'm willing to come. Mercy was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied. In just a minute, we're going to sing an invitation. The song is all about God's free salvation. It's free, but it's not cheap. It's free to you, but it costs God his only son. But as we sing, it simply says, freely. Freely, I come. I come and I give my life to you today. I promise you, as we sing, there's also going to be praying. Pray, O Lord, let some soul come to you today. Whether it be little, whether it be old, let some soul walk the aisle and say yes to Jesus. Friends, that's what makes our day. That's what keeps the church doors open. I ask you this morning to respond to that invitation. Let's stand together. Miss Judy, would you come and lead us freely, freely to be on the screen. Let's sing, I Stand Right Here. Asking you to come and say yes to Jesus.
Jesus' name, thank you. Deacon, would you join me up front, please? We come now to observe the ordinance of the Lord's Supper, given to us to celebrate the memory of his broken body and his shed blood. It is said on that night before he was betrayed at the conclusion of the feast of the Passover, which he and his disciples were celebrating. He took the bread, the symbol of his broken body, and after he blessed it, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "This is my body, which is given for you." Bruce, would you ask the blessing over the symbol of the broken body of Jesus?
Heavenly Father, we come to you to observe this holy ordinance, Lord. I ask that you forgive us of our sins, Lord. I ask that you cleanse our hearts. And Lord, as we partake of this symbol of your body, Lord, I pray that we really think about what you did for us on the cross, Lord, the sacrifice you made with your body. And Lord, help us to remember that at that point, not only were you the Son of God, but you were also man, and your body was broken. And Father, I pray that
John 6:58 says, this is the bread which came down out of heaven. That's what you have in your hand. Not as the fathers ate and died, but he that eats this bread shall live forever. The symbol of the broken body of the Lord Jesus Christ upon Calvary is what we're reflecting on today. We're reflecting on the thorns that pierced his brow, the spear that pierced his side, and the nails that pierced his hands and feet. May we partake of the symbol of the broken body of Jesus and remember Calvary. He that eateth this bread shall live forever. On that same night, our Lord took the cup and having blessed it, gave it to his disciples and said, this is my blood which was shed for you. And would you ask the blessing over the symbol of the blood, please?
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time we can take this cup and the blood that is shed on Calvary for all our sins.
since the beginning of time, almost, God pointed to the shedding of the blood. From the blood that he shed, the clove of Adam and Eve, to the countless numbers of thousands of sacrifices of sheep, goats, and oxen upon the altars in the Old Testament. And someone asked, why all the blood? Because Christianity is a bloody religion. But it all points to the blood that Jesus shed upon Calvary for our sins. The book of Hebrews said he went once and for all and made the perfect sacrifice. His blood was shed for you and I. May we partake of the symbol of the shed blood of Jesus today and thank him for what he has given and done for us. The Bible says, according to the law, I may almost say all things are cleansed with blood. Apart from the shedding of blood, there's no remission. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. May we partake of the blood. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are proclaiming the Lord's death till he comes again. Let's stand together and be dismissed.
Don't forget your choice over here.